are the briefs from last time. And these are the briefs from this time.
Oh, you didn't have any for it last time?
I had them last time, but I forgot to give them out.
I saw some interesting new shirling plates, but maybe not new, but I hadn't seen them.
Yeah.
As an older woman, as a grandmother type.
Oh, yes, yes. All right.
Fortunately, it's being recorded.
you're not on record forever and ever. Hey, Jack made it.
Lisa said she saw you on Channel 4 today.
Yeah.
Did you do astrology, basic astrology?
Yeah, something like that. It's called.
Everyone's silent here in the class.
Hey, Jack. Welcome back.
Thank you. You too.
Yeah.
I haven't seen you for a while.
Well, yeah.
Did you get some new students last week?
What?
Some new students?
New students? No. No.
Yeah.
It's too late in the year.
Oh, is it?
I think so.
Because of...
Oh, okay. Get one of each of those, Jack.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
All right. We are on the Cat Stevens emotionality. There's just three of them, actually. And this is going to be a lot about life and psychology and quite a few other things and very little bit about astrology, but we'll live through it. Because what is important is what astrology points to and not astrology itself. The only reason I study astrology at all is to so that people by use of it can get at what it points to. And one of the things that it points to is psychology. And I love reading psychology. And I have benefited a great deal from it in my personal life and in my astrological understanding. I'm much better equipped to understand people by understanding their psychology. And I would recommend that all astrology students read psychology. And probably the best people to read are the depth psychologists. That is the Freudians and the Jungians. And most notably Carl Jung. However, when you read Carl Jung, it is not without drawbacks. And that is because sometimes there's great brilliance and at the same time, right next to it, intentional resistance to enlightenment, side by side. It's really frustrating. And when that occurs, he's usually trying to discount spiritual things. Not because he doesn't believe in them, but he wants to make sure that his psychology is more acceptable to the world, especially the world of material science. And he even says this, that he does this. One example of this is something that he calls enantiodromia. It's a nice word that you can take home and tell all your friends, oh, I know what enantiodromia is, and they'll look at you in as if you've gone mad. His notion of enantiodromia is that when an individual proceeds dangerously far in one direction of a psychological principle, an internal psychological principle, the opposite pole of that principle becomes manifest in order to compensate so that one doesn't become so extreme and go out on a tangent. Now you can override that, and then you do go out on a tangent, and that ends up in being some kind of insanity of some kind or another. Now this is a really splendid notion that he has. In fact, we find the principle of enantiodromia in various ways in astrology itself, right in the zodiac. You find it in signs that are adjacent to each other. Each one compensates for the one that has come before it. Even in signs that are at right angles, at the turning points of the spiritual year, there is a form of enantiodromia. And, of course, the planetary opposites do something similar. But the most important examples of enantiodromia are found in opposite signs and in opposition aspects. There is an example that occurs in Jung, and to me it's a very vexing example, and it occurs in the discussion of the conversion experience of St. Paul, from being Saul to Paul. Now, Jung maintains that the hard, brutal, repressive qualities of St. Paul were becoming dangerously strong in his zeal, so that the opposite qualities were coming forth, and what was the conversion experience was just something that allowed them to come forth in such a way that he couldn't harm himself and the world much more. He states the same thing with the conversion experiences of Raymond Lull, the famous alchemist. Now, enantiodromia is a brilliant idea, and it probably did play some role in the conversion experience of St. Paul. But what is really painful about it is that he makes no mention at all of the spiritual experience that was in the conversion. It was as if the spiritual thing that happened to him, like seeing into third heaven and perhaps beyond, it had no relevance whatsoever. If it had been mentioned, it would probably have been called a product of extreme emotionality, which is one of Carl Jung's favorite things to say whenever something comes along that he doesn't like. He didn't like magical phenomena, because that involved mysticism. And so whenever somebody told him about a miracle or a miraculous experience, he would say, oh, those kinds of things happen with extreme emotionality. And this is a man that wouldn't even go across the street to see the greatest mystic of his time. Literally, Ramani Maharshi was in the same city that Jung was, and Jung wouldn't go to see him because he said, I know those things already. But I don't want to be laying it hard on Carl Jung, but he does have his faults. It's probably true what Carl Jung would say, because miraculous prayers and other phenomena are the product of extreme emotions. But they are extreme emotions that are under the control of the spirit, and that they can accomplish what the spirit wants to accomplish. But the greater truth about all of this is that Christ-centered spirituality permeated Paul's life afterwards. And his conversion, and after his conversion, the qualities of his life were not enantiodromically changed that way. He was just as zealous for Christ as he had been zealous against Christ. So this wasn't the perfect example of enantiodromia. Now we're looking at the horoscope of Cat Stevens. And Cat Stevens, is someone who has undergone several quite radical transformations. In fact, he has undergone a religious conversion. And we want to try to understand that. And we want to try to understand it because it's very pertinent to the emotionality of this chart. There are oppositions in this chart, such as the sun being opposite to the moon, but they're not strong. And the nature of the opposition is not like the quality of an enantiodromia. So we'll come to that later on and talk about that in detail. So it's pretty obvious that none of the oppositions or opposing forces in this horoscope are like an enantiodromia. But that isn't the only way that a religious conversion takes place. In this case, it is similar to what we just said about St. Paul. It is clearly much more of a spiritual phenomenon than it is a psychological phenomenon. In reality, the psychology of a person is just the tool of the spirit. And the spirit is definitely not the product of the psychology. If anything, the whole psychology is, as mystics would claim, the product of the spirit. Now we've made some pretty strong statements here, and now it is our task to try to verify and substantiate these statements and along the way appreciate this emotionality. When we look at the fact sheet, if our estimation system is correct, Venus is the strongest planet in this horoscope. It's clearly the life ruler. Venus rules Libra, and it is in the sign Gemini. Now, it's been my observation over a lot of years that Libra and Gemini are the signs of the zodiac that are most amenable to change or adaptation or transformation, and especially to conversion, especially conversion by persuasion. So, conversions are not surprising in this horoscope. We remember that even Gandhi has the sun in Libra. And Gandhi went from being a vegetarian to being a non-vegetarian and then back to being a vegetarian without having ever eaten meat. He became convinced and convicted through persuasion that it was all right to eat meat. And then he became convinced and convicted through greater persuasion that it was not all right to eat meat. And so that's a fairly decent demonstration of the way that there is a conversion in the sign Libra, for example.
Is that because they're like both Gemini and Libra are air signs? Because like Aquarius is fixed air signs,
yeah.
So that wouldn't be open.
No. I think it's just the nature of those two signs. They're intellectual and they're quite liking of persuasion, but for different reasons. Mercury likes the ability to jump over and take the opposite side, and Libra really cares about the other much more than it cares about itself. Now, it seems this Neptune is conjoined the ascendant, and this seems to indicate his ability to almost magically change his external image. And he had an uncanny way of converting his external image to something that the world really wanted to see. Right now, if you look at him, if you go on his website, or if you see pictures of him in the news or something like that, he recently visited with George Bush in order to plead for mercy for Muslims around the world. Right now, he presents an Orthodox Muslim image. It isn't perfect, but it is such a good image of an Orthodox Muslim that you would almost think that he was born and raised in an Arabic or Islamic society. He does a really good job at that. So this indicates a camouflage ability, as Neptune conjoined the ascendant would seem to be. And he's got this stylish kind of camouflage. He didn't just become a Muslim and walk around in Western clothes anymore. He became a Muslim and dressed in Mideastern clothes. But beside being a planet of camouflage and illusion, Neptune is a planet of spiritual activity. And then when you have Neptune conjoined the ascendant the way it is, a conversion to a different spiritual outlook is quite likely. Looking back at the ruler of the ascendant again, the strongest aspect to Venus is the conjunction to Uranus, which is another planet of spiritual activity. Gemini, the sign in which that conjunction takes place, is a very changeable sign. And the ninth house is the house of religion, so religious and spiritual conversions are not only believable, they're quite likely. And that's exactly what we have. There's no surprises about that. The horoscope is clearly his horoscope. Now, in all of this, it's important to notice the strong Venus presence. Venus is the strongest planet, and the next two strongest planets are Mars and the Moon, which are other primary significators in the emotionality. So this is a really emotional individual. The Sun is in Cancer, and Cancer is highly emotional. From this, it's obvious that the whole character is emotional. And with that being the case, his whole being is defined or known or understood through the emotions. They're really, really important to him. That his emotions are the basis for his actions, that's perfectly acceptable. That's what the desire body is for. So what we're saying is not only was the conversion a understandable thing with this horoscope, what we're also saying is that it was not only a spiritual act, it was an emotional act. It was an emotional conversion. First, let's continue a little bit with the simple considerations that we've been looking at. We see that the strongest planets of each of the primary emotional significators, that is Moon, Mars, Venus, and then a little bit lower down, Saturn and Jupiter, the strongest aspect of each one of them is a benefic. And if you look at all of the aspects of the emotional significators, most of them, by a 3-to-1 ratio, are benefics over malefics. And most of the benefics are stronger than the malefics for all of these planets. So the logical conclusion from all of this is that not only is he emotional and capable of conversion, his whole intent is benign. He has feelings for people, and they are good feelings for people, and he wants to help people. This is not just a publicity stunt or something like that. And he didn't think this all through and say, I'm going to become a Muslim. He felt this and became a Muslim. It's also reasonable to conclude from this that his religious and spiritual conversion is good for him and is good for the world. His purpose is usually seen, not objective or aim or goal or anything like that, but purpose is usually seen in the ninth house. And with Venus being there as the ruler of the chart, his purpose is love. And as a consequence, his personal religion is a religion of love. Now, it doesn't matter one bit that Islam has a long history of violence and that it has a long history of forced conversion, because that doesn't make any difference to him. For him, it is a vehicle of love, whether it is objectively so in the rest of the world or not. And we're dealing with his horoscope, and we're not putting Islam on the inspection table. the only thing that matters then are his feelings, and his feelings are good. With Neptune on the ascendant, it's possible that his internal emotions are also attuned to external reality, and that what he feels inwardly, he can see outwardly. And eventually he may see things that are discordant, but that's eventually. For now, he's happy, and it seems that he has every right for being happy. Conversion experiences usually happen suddenly. The buildup to a conversion experience might be very long, and it might be very gradual. If they are due to an antiudromia, it takes a long time of a lot of extremism to carry things that far. For the ego to be stretched so much in the limits in one direction that it is forced to let go of something and swing to the other direction. If the conversion is due to spiritual causes, which is the case with Cat Stevens, it takes a long time to build and organize the soul material that you can have a spiritual experience that's going to result in a conversion. Obviously, spiritual conversions as opposed to enantiodromic conversions are more rare, because not that many people have built up that soul material. I think as we proceed, and lifetime after lifetime of experience gets processed in between rebirths, more people will be ready for spiritual conversions. Not necessarily to a religion, but to an awakening of inner spiritual truths. So it takes us a long time to accumulate the facts if we're going to have an intellectual conversion. You don't look at a few facts and say, oh, this whole theory is wrong. You look at a lot of things and you become more and more uneasy, and then you have accumulated enough facts that you can say this can't be true. Now, in the case of a spiritual conversion, the change may be sudden. But even at that, it takes a long time for the change to percolate through the entire character and to render it into a new character. The waking consciousness, or the spirit that sees things, that might be instantaneous, but there are bad habits that hang around. I've had a minor conversion experience, and it's taken 40 years, and some of the things still haven't dissolved. It may be a long time before they are completely penetrated. So we're finding that the conversion of Cat Stevens is a spiritual one, and that we find that when we look at Venus, the life ruler, that's consistent with this. The strongest aspect of Venus is the conjunction to Uranus, which rules direct intuition. And by direct intuition, we mean an intuition that is not accompanied by thought. It's just a truth that you know immediately. Uranian intuitions are always sudden. Neptunian intuitions are close to sudden, but they're usually less dramatic and they're much more complex. We're speaking about a conversion that is brought about by the spiritual existence of something in us that is triggered by intuition. That is, new things. And Uranus rules new things. Now, this brings about an interesting astrological problem, which is not in astrological technique, but in the whole philosophy of science about astrology. Yes?
I have a question. You mentioned that Venus, the conjunction of Venus and Uranus makes for
a sudden experience of love or
an intuition.
Yes.
Does any conjunction, any lower planet conjunction with Uranus give you?
Almost any planet will, yes, but we haven't gotten to yet describing the kind of intuitions that he's going to have and the kind of experience that he has. But any planet can. Yeah, your electromechanical consciousness has to do with Uranus Mars. It seems to be a fact about astrology that astrology can't tell us what something new is. Because astrology is about everything that is already. If something is new, it is unprecedented. And it comes from a state of being that is beyond astrology. And this is why we study astrology, so we can see how people can bring in something new and what they need to do to bring in something new, because they're not doing so well with the old as it is now. And you bring in new players to see what can be done. However, even though astrology can't tell you what the something new is going to be, it can tell you other things about newness. For one, a very simple thing, we can tell what the likelihood of any native is to have an experience of something new. In this case, because of the very strong presence of Uranus and Neptune, especially Uranus, in ways and places that are likely to change, newness or new things or new outlooks are likely. Moreover, in this horoscope, it is a horoscope that is amenable to change altogether. There are a lot of planets in cardinal and common signs. Saturn and Pluto are the planets that are most likely to resist change or to resist new things coming in or to ignore them if they do come in. But Saturn and Pluto are very weak and they couldn't be much called on to be impedimental if they wanted to be. The moon is in a fixed sign, but it happens to be a fixed sign that is the most forward-looking of all the six fixed signs. Aquarius is the sign of futurism. So we can see that this is a horoscope that is amenable to a lot of new things. The moon is also in the strongest aspect in this horoscope, and that aspect happens to be a very dynamic and very changing aspect, and it is an aspect that is associated with things like fads and novelties and manias and things like that. And that is the Mars trine the moon. Very strong, very liking fresh things. Another thing is we cannot tell what the new is going to be, but we can tell why the individual is likely to have newness and novelty or converting experiences. In this case, it is obvious that finding something new is intended. This is not a case of accidental newness, which is often the case. Sometimes human beings are such blockheads that it has to happen by accident that they discover something in doing something that they weren't intending. This is somebody that intends to do this. And the intention is not phony, it's a real intention. We must remember that this is a horoscope of an artist, and a very creative artist at that. And I think that his songs have some of the most ingenious uses of words that I've ever heard in any songs, and I think they're excellent in that way. The words that he chooses are very remarkable, and he puts them together very remarkably. Now, some of that is due to the fact that Libra is rising, which is probably the most lyrical of all the signs, and the fact that Venus is in Gemini, which is another ace kind of signature of a lyrical person. So he's a lyrical person. But this is somebody who is used to practicing and inviting spontaneous creativity. And this is somebody that practices looking at things in new ways, whether there is a new discovery or not. He does it all the time in creative songwriting sessions. So he can practice inviting by doing spontaneous creativity. Now, if you look at his conversion, it's very different than the conversion of Emanuel Swedenborg. Emanuel Swedenborg was a practicing mining geologist. And all day long, for he was quite an ingenious geologist, but his whole occupation was studying geology. And then one day, bam, he had a completely life-changing experience, and he had full-blown clairvoyance overnight. And it all came without invitation. So this is a very different kind of psychology, and Cat Stevens, he's looking for it. And also, the invitation by Cat Stevens was more than just artistic. Beside being a pop artist, or a folk artist, or whatever you want to call him in that stage, he was a religious seeker. He was a seeker before he got into Islam. And you can see that again because of the strong presence of Uranus and Neptune in this chart. And the fact that the ninth house is where Uranus and the life ruler are. That's the house of seeking for something higher. Sometimes people do experience spontaneous baptisms of the Holy Spirit. It happens to people, but it happens with a much greater percentage to people who go to Pentecostal meetings, because they're setting themselves up for it. They're opening themselves to that. And that is what happened with Cat Stevens, only in a different form than Pentecostalism. So the new is present and imminent around us all the time. We actually exist in a sea of things that are new. But most of the time, we're completely unaware of it. Everything that exists in the world now that we see around us was at one time completely new. It didn't exist. And so that is the relationship. What we call cosmos is a subset or a condensation out of the newness that is there. And it's there all the time. So the new and the old hat, or the chaos and the cosmos, exist or coexist simultaneously. But we usually don't see the new things.
I noticed that he doesn't seem to have anything in Earth in this chart, does he?
Yeah, yeah. He's not a practical person.
Yeah.
When the new enters into organization and the structure of the old, only so much can be let in without things descending into complete chaos and anarchy. And Saturn is usually the doorman to that. Saturn is the one that says, no, we don't want any of this newfangled stuff here, or it is like concentrating on what is so much that there is no room, there's no gap, or there's no opening for something new to come in. Perhaps in the future, when the beings that are evolving in the cosmos as we see it now are stronger and more capable accommodating to new things, the new things will enter in more frequently, and you know, everything will be made new on a regular basis. Now, when the new does enter the old, it usually cannot be appreciated for itself. It can only be appreciated in terms of the old. I had my first experience that way. First time I tasted a mango, I had a very clever description of it. I said that a mango was a peach that went to heaven. But I couldn't see the newness to me of mangoes except in terms of something that I knew before, like a peach. And that's the way new things are. It's very hard to see them for themselves, and the only tool that we have is to be able to see them in terms of the old. So the more conversant we become with the old, provided we do not take it for granted and provided that we do not cling to it as the only source of reality, the more conversant we become with the old, the more capable we will be to assimilate more newness into our lives in the future. So it's something like a spiral of Archimedes, that you learn something and then you have a greater capacity to learn more, and it's the same way with experiencing something new. When you know something well enough and you can see that something is different, you have just experienced something new. And the more you know, the more you can know because of the greater newness. Now, there's a great variety in the appreciation of newness. Or I should say there's another variety in the appreciation of newness. It's a different kind of newness. And that is the newness that is associated with Mars. And this kind of newness has to do with who is the first to experience something. And it's almost, Mars is almost egotistical about wanting fresh things or to be the very first at something. Men who are more subject to the influence of Mars are the ones that always like the feel of a new car. It's new. No one has ever driven in it before. We will not include a discussion of virgins in this in this topic. Mars is not conjoined to the ascendant, but it is in the east, and it does give some influence to the east. Mars is in Libra, and it likes trendy new clothes. That's the swashbuckler sign, Mars in Libra. And Mars and the moon are the second and third strongest planets, and this is the strongest aspect. So the best way to describe this whole setup is exciting. It is emotionally exciting, it is artistically exciting, and in a way, even romantically exciting. So this aspect represents when interest is awakening the impulse to action through becoming a motive desire, something that excites us or stimulates us. Even the interest excited is it's a positive thing. It's not just passive and receptive. It's something that goes out there. Early in his career, he was very much in touch with fashionable things and with all the crazes and manias. He seemed to be right on the pulse of what was good and what was the next thing coming along. Now, that was early in his life, and his life hasn't always been that shallow, but it has never been especially deep. That is because he's not an especially deep person. And sometimes pop stars are pop stars because they do not go too deep. There's nothing wrong with not being deep. It's just we need people that do that. Not everybody wants to be, not everybody wants profound and heavy things. Now, because the aspect of the moon and Mars is in air signs, the feelings are not likely to be personal feelings. And it's not likely to be personal excitement. Thus, it's likely that he's not so much going to become a cult figure. He never really was a cult figure, even though his Cancer part would probably like that. All right. So we can't verbalize, and we can't be knowledgeable in a familiar way with what is new. But we can tell where it enters into the part of our being that is receptive to it. And that's what we want to do with astrology. We also want to understand to what end the new is brought in, because the new has its own intentions, but the personality calls for the new because it needs help in a given area, and it needs to be shocked or changed or converted into a new outlook on things. All right, let's start looking at things that way. The ninth house is a house indicating opportunities for experiencing purpose, and it's usually higher purpose. As we know, cultural vehicles for experiencing higher purpose are things like religion and philosophy. And the institutions of religion and philosophy form to us the spiritual experience in a way that we can handle it. So there is something about the new in itself that is formless, and we are using it to bring it into a realm of distinct forms. Now, it happens that sometimes religious and philosophical institutions are too formal, and they're too dogmatic, and the sense of purpose then becomes dimmed, and it even becomes weakened to the point that it becomes ineffectual. After a long time, a church or a religion becomes ineffectual because it is too hardened and crystallized, and it is far away from the needs of the people. It isn't close to that. And when that takes place, even the religion itself has to have a renewal, or it has to be replaced by something else. Now, that renewal or that replacement of a religion is sometimes revolutionary, and it is brought about through some Iranian force that supplants it and puts something else in its place, something new, something that is excited. Uranus, we know, can be very, very radical, and it can be explosive, but it is not clear that it is explosive because of its spiritual power, or because of the nature of the new, or whether it is due to the hardened resistance of that which receives it. It's probably due to both. The hardened condition that tries to hold it in, instead of going with it and being bent by it, it tries to hold it in until the energy builds up and it explodes. And that's the kind of thing that we're talking about. Now, one would think that this could be told how the converting experience is going to be by looking at the disposition of the old things. Now, in this horoscope, as we said earlier, there are three planets fixed, and Saturn and Pluto are weak, and the moon is a forward-looking sign and in a very dynamic aspect. Thus, we can see that the resistance to the new or the status quo from the past is neither immense nor is it especially hardened. So the disposition of Uranus, which is mixed, is not especially explosive, especially being together with the sweet and gentle Venus. There is the square of Uranus to Mars, but that is not very strong. And beside, this is an unusual square that is only in air signs, and it is less resistant to, the air element is probably the least resistant to the rapid expansion of new things, and it is the least disrupted by it. So we can see that this is a chart that is not going to have a radical kind of conversion experience. It's going to be something gentle, and the effect in the character is going to be, certainly going to make a new person out of them, but it's going to be gentle and gradual. Now, the conjunction of Uranus with Venus is the most important thing because it is most strong. And it's important in a peculiar way. It is an aspect between planetary octaves, which means a coming together of two very different expressions of the same quality. And in this case, that quality is love. And the two expressions of love are the divine love in the form of altruism and the individual love for a distinct person, a distinct individual. In Gemini, that love is likely to be light. It's not going to be heavy and syrupy or anything like that. It's likely to be delicate and even air-drawn. Now, this helps us to clarify his character in regard to his emotionality. It shows him to be a person seeking and to some extent finding a higher kind of love, and that love applies to his fellow human beings. The airy signs, after all, are human signs, and they're all inclined toward humanitarianism toward other people. Now, because of the ninth house positioning, and because of his experience of his divine nature in artistic creativity, and because of his spiritual seeking of higher purposes, it cannot be a purely humanistic religion or philosophy. It does have a spiritual element. It is not the modern humanism. Now, it must be noted that this day, and in fact increasingly in his life, he is given to humane works within the religious structure. It's very hard to tell from this horoscope whether he is more God-oriented or whether he is more human service-oriented. I tried to get to that, but it was way too hard for me. It would have taken too long for me to get at it. Now, this is all very curious, because I've read the entire Quran, and I have never found a single reference to the concept or to the word love. Benignity is there, generosity is there, but the concept of love, I couldn't find anywhere in it. Now, this doesn't mean that Muslims are less loving human beings, even though their religion places much less emphasis on it. However, I do have some doubt about all of this, because all religious experience, not the dogma, but the experience, has some quality of love about it. There have been great figures of love in every religion, and it is to that he is drawn. So we can say that his conversion experience is not to the letter of Islam, even though it may look now like he's trying to live according to the letter of Islam. I have my own feeling that he might even be one of the great loving figures within the Muslim religion, because he has that kind of strength of character in that direction. So we have to look at him as being a renewer and a starter of new trends. You might say that he is the cosmic antidote to the terrorism that we hear so much more about, because his nature is different. Now, Islam is not currently a religion of meekness and gentleness, and that might be what his opportunity is, to express and fulfill his character, to bring that into the religion. A person does not have to be an authority to do that. It can be done through cultural vehicles, as we've seen with all of the emphasis on air signs. Cultural vehicles are his forte. He has strength in that. The fact is that he's active right now in deeds of love and philanthropy, but those actions are both meeting the basic needs of people, seeing that people get fed and such, but he's also doing work with education and helping people to expand themselves through education. At the same time, he is also still active as an artist musician. I haven't heard any of his recent music. For a while, I was told that it was pretty sing-song in some kind of standard Muslim format, but I think his creativity is winning out over that. Now, there's only one question that I have about this, and I have a concern about it, and it's something fascinating for me to think on. I'll let you think on it also, because I won't have any definite answers. And that the astrological part of that question is, how much can the influence of a house and what that house stands for be stretched? Or how much can the form of the opportunity budge? That is, how much leeway or tolerance is there to a house? That's what we're trying to get at. In India, the ninth house is the house of Dharma. And that's a good idea to get to use to get at this idea, though I'm sure he would not approve. Dharma is the religious and moral order of things. From this we can see that to the ninth house there is a strong element of form, not like the kind of form that is of the second house of an object, but it's an ordering kind of form. We see this in a number of ways. We see this in religious observances and practices, which become very formalized. Or we see it in the formalization of theology into all kinds of tenets and creeds and all of those kinds of moral codes of behavior and things like that. It becomes very much of a form. Thus, when a dharma is established, it sometimes hardens too much. And there are famous statements in Hindu literature that say that it must be reestablished or it must be renewed when people either fall away from it or when it becomes too hardened. At this time in the evolution of the psychology of conversion experiences, it seems to be that when a person has a conversion experience, the individual seems to take on more of the whole package of the dogma than someone who was born and raised within that religion. Because someone born and raised within a religion takes it all with a grain of salt, because it has an old hat kind of feature. But when somebody is a convert, they convert totally in each and little, every little observance, and they become rather unpleasant to be around, I must say. And it doesn't make any difference to what they have converted to. This seems to be what we see in Uranus at this very materialistic point in our evolution. It gets us right to the basis of astrology. Someone in our times will have an Uranian intuition. And with that intuition, they'll know indubitably that something is true. And they will hang on to the effect of that experience, because they can't hang on to the intuition itself, because the intuition is there and gone. And they'll hang on to the effect of that experience for the duration of their life. It's as though lightning had struck and etched a figure into stone, or into rock, I should say. And ever after, the individual or individuals who saw that event look at the figure in the rock, because that's indubitable. But they neglect thinking about or putting their attention on the lively lightning, which is as powerful as it is formless, elusive, and even unpredictable. Now the question is whether the medium of hardened orthodoxy into which the Iranian religious conversion experience has struck will be totally accepted and dominate and become the prevalent determinant of the person's life afterwards, or whether in this case of Cat Stevens he has enough spontaneous creativity to realize the source of that experience and continue with the conversion experience in a whole series of intuitive experiences, asking for new and more. This is something that happens every time that there is a conversion experience of this intuitive type, especially an Iranian type. Now, right now, the case appears to be with Cat Stevens that he has taken on and is taking on more and more all of the tenets of Orthodox Islam. I don't think it will continue to be that way, and I think that music will be his salvation in that by carrying on with creative activity and doing so in the way that he has done all of his life, I think that will ease him away from Orthodox dependence.
Mystic, you know, there's mystic Islam. I mean, he
may yes. Yes. Turkey. Yes. Really? Yeah. You're anticipating other things that I'm going to be talking about. I'm going to be talking about the... Oh, you're right here. I'm just three or four notes away from it. Now, if he expected or invited continuing experiences, it would continue on. And that happens. Well, a person makes one discovery, and if they get the sense of that, they never want to lose that forever. It all depends on what you hang on to. We have historic instances of somebody who did have a historic, who did have an Iranian conversion experience and hung on to that and left orthodoxy all behind, and that is the poet Rumi. After his first experience, he continued throughout his life to have intuitive experiences, and they kept getting better and better. Now, in the case of Rumi, it may have happened that way because when he had his first experience, he was already extremely orthodox. He was a dogmatist. He had written a set of encyclopedias of Islam. And then he had the experience. And when he had the experience, because he had been so hard in his orthodoxy before, he said, you know, that's worth nothing. And he literally burned his entire encyclopedias that he had written on orthodoxy and spent the rest of his life inviting and listening to intuitive experiences. In contrast, what he experienced in his life, he could never go back to that. He couldn't go back to what he was before. Now, this gives us a good astrological picture. If we think about lightning engraving rock, as it becomes grounded and completely played out, that is an excellent image or metaphor for understanding the fall position of Uranus in Taurus. It's as if all of the electricity, all of the lightning of creativity, when it is grounded by meeting something hard, it makes an impression, but it is grounded and it's weakened. Even though enantiodromia doesn't appear to be a major causal agency for his conversion, I think we should look at some of the oppositions and frictions and snags to his conversion and his ongoing awakening that there are in this life. And since Venus, again, is life ruler and so strong, let's look at her first. beside the conjunction to Uranus, Venus forms two other aspects. And the strongest is the sextile to Saturn, which is about two-thirds the strength of the conjunction. Now, in the way that we've been looking at things, this is something like a Maslow aspect. Maslow, who was wrong at large, had the idea that religion and spirituality come at the end of individual and societal development when all of the basics have been taken care of. In short, religion was for rich people and not for short, because only the rich people were ready for it, and only they had enough culture for it. And that's obviously not true. The fact of the matter is that spirituality is present all the time. It's one thought or one intuition away. At our present stage of development, it's always here. And strangely enough, spirituality in the religion appeals much more to the poor people and the underprivileged rather than the privileged that Maslow said that it was for. It's because they recognize the need for it. For them, it may mean the difference between surviving and progressing or just going under. And the funny thing is usually those at the top of the cultural development are less inclined towards spirituality because they're so much into their satisfaction of things. They're the type that eat lunch at the top of the Overture Center. All right. Nonetheless, there is the fact that there is a slow progressive development towards spirituality. People are learning from their experiences, and whether they make mistakes or if they perform life flawlessly, they're slowly building a soul material. And they're preparing themselves for a spirituality, but not exactly in the same way as Maslow thinks. So when we look at the sextile of the Venus to Saturn, it seems to indicate that he has a well-developed foundation in love. He has a faithful kind of love, he has a true kind of love, and without this basis, perhaps the higher kind of love that comes through the spontaneous experience with Venus and Uranus wouldn't be possible. It's very easy to be carried off by high-blown romanticism, to have swoons and things like that without having grounding. In terms of his art, we can see that he can improvise and excel at improvisation because of his very good understanding of the basics and because he was religious in practicing. And those are things that are shown by the sextile of Venus and Uranus. Now, the Uranus part of this same pattern shows him to be cognizant of tradition. And it shows how the Uranus part. The Uranus is sextile to Saturn also. Yeah, it's weaker.
How does that work then?
Well, this is what I'm trying to explain right now.
Okay.
Yeah. So the Saturn part of this same pattern shows that he recognizes tradition. And he recognizes the past, and he recognizes how the new can fit into it. So even though this is a spontaneous experience, it is not without deliberation. He has thought some, or he has experienced some through his lives, about the relationship of the past to the future. And so that he's ready to carry something like that out. Now it's not, you know, this aspect is not so strong that we can say with certainty that he will not fall into the pitfall of accepting that orthodoxy from the past and getting locked into it forever, but he is aware that those kinds of things happen. Now this pattern, especially since it's anchored in Gemini, has the quality, by looking at the past and bringing in the new and bringing it in with love, that being centered in Gemini has the quality of creative imitation. Gemini is the planet of aping, which is imitation. It is repetition until you can imitate something perfectly. Now, that was very evident when he was a pop artist. He could give a good imitation of whatever he wanted to in terms of style. Now, he does the same thing with giving a good imitation of an Arab or of a Muslim. And it's easily good enough to be accepted, and he is accepted because he is a believer. But it isn't perfect. When you look at his website, when you look at the pictures, it isn't a perfect imitation of what they're like. It's, you know, that's the way it always is when you do a retrofit with an outsider. It doesn't work out perfectly. It's always the case. Probably an example that everybody's more familiar with is white guys playing Chicago-style blues. They get the music and they get some of the feeling, but it's not the same thing. You know what I mean? It's close, but not really there. Now, what is interesting about all of this is what is in it and what isn't. Now, Venus conjoins Uranus, and both of them sextile Saturn. And Pluto squares Mars, but Venus does not. Now, the Mars-Uranus is interesting in itself because it indicates a mild temperamentality. And the fact that it even exists is remarkable. Normally, when a person loses temper, that's done when a person doesn't get their way. Now, in this case, there are no distinct inhibitors to Mars or any kind of martial energy. There are no major blocks and there are no frustrations that would normally hold energy until it explodes. The whole horoscope is quite fluent, so there should be no reason for anger. But still, we have this brief explosive anger aspect. The most reasonable hypothesis that I found to understand this is to look at it in the overall pattern. Things in the spirit happen so quickly, and they're so creative, and they happen with impossible rapidity. It's impossible for the personality to keep up with it. And so it is in the differential, the natural differential between the spirit in the intuition and trying to bring it through the personality that there is a seeming pseudo-blockage. And it isn't really a blockage, and that's where the temper comes in. So that's a common problem to anyone who studies things spiritual, because intuitively we know that something is right, but our personality blocks. Another interesting thing that's in this pattern is what isn't in, and that is the Venus. Venus does not square Mars. This means that his love nature is not exceedingly tainted with lust or with personal desire. And this is what makes him much more likely to have the altruistic qualities and to be able to have them change and convert his entire character. If he were more lustful with all the trendiness, and he was a handsome guy, and he knew how to dress and do all of those things, that would have been a huge, big sidetrack to him. So he is married and has children and all of that, but he didn't allow himself to get lost in the misdirection of emotionality in lust and personal desire and things of that nature. It's always fascinating when you look at a whole pattern like that and how it comes together. Now, the only thing that is vaguely like an enantiodromia in the whole chart is the sun opposite moon. And that's really pretty weak and too different from the nature of an enantiodromia to qualify. In that enantiodromia, there is an extreme predilection that can only be taken care of by an alert kind of action in order to free oneself from it. usually things are overbalanced in one direction when that occurs. In this case, the opposition is balanced. The moon is a little stronger than the sun, but there is balance. Also, the sun opposite moon is an indecisive aspect and not an extremist aspect. If we add to this the fact that the aspect is separating, that means things are going away from extremes. So these are all reasons why it isn't that kind of thing that was so dear to Jung. However, both the moon and Cancer are involved, so it is important to understanding the feelings. In fact, in the written brief, much more is spent on the feeling nature than we are doing right now in the oral part. It's a difficult pattern to get an understanding of, because there are various levels of meaning to it, because there are various astrological levels to it, and things seem to flip-flop every level that you look at. So let's look at a little bit of that, but not all of it, because this is when I was running out of time and I was writing as fast as I could write and I knew I wasn't going to get everything said. I never will, probably. Capricorn is on the cusp of the fourth, and Cancer is on the cusp of the tenth. Consequently, the subjective attitudes of Cancer are located in the place where we normally expect objectivity. That is the opportunity field that we call the 10th house. When everything is standing right out there for all to see and measure, that's quite objective. So the simple thing that we can say about this, and the obvious thing that we can say about this, is even though he sought it out, he's probably not comfortable with his fame and celebrity, because he feels himself or sees himself inwardly as an emotional being, but he has to be out there for all the world to see. So he's idiosyncratic and maybe even timid about his icon status in Britain and to some extent around the world. Perhaps this is why the Neptune in Libra on the ascendant camouflage, it shows him that he could use that in a way that he was difficult to pin down, because he doesn't want to be pinned down. He wants to be shy like a little Cancer boy inside of himself. It's just past the full moon, so there has been a shift from the active life to the contemplative life. Astrologers going all the way back to the poet Dante have said that the first half of the moon is the active life and the second half is the contemplative life. So he's in the contemplative phase, but he's up there in the 10th house and out there for everybody to see, and he has all those Mars aspects that he has to do and be active. And this is another reason why we can see that he's uncomfortable about his feeling life. And he's uncomfortable about his creative emotionality and what it brings him into. He has basic motivations of being loving. He has a very good sense of beauty, which we haven't talked about because we've done that with other people and there's not time to do everything. Now, the moon side of this opposition is equally uncomfortable. Capricorn is on the cusp, but it's a little bit easier for the moon because the moon is the abstract ruler of the fourth house. So the discomfort of the moon is not with the situation in the fourth house, like the discomfort of the sun in Cancer is with the situation in the 10th house. It's more in the sphere of attitude that there is discomfort and uneasiness. The moon is in a dry, impersonal sign, Aquarius, which is way out of character for the moon. So she seems to have objective attitudes in her feeling nature, But the feeling nature is always supposed to be subjective. This is what's happening to me. And so the responses to stimuli are the order of the day in the region of feeling. You feel things so that you can respond to them with the correct motivation. And here it's asking for objective feelings, and that's a little bit uncomfortable in his inner consciousness. This obviously shows a discomfort in emotions, and especially in feelings. Now, this might be an evolutionary matter. You know, not all of our diseases that we get are a matter of cause and consequence. Some of them are a matter of adjusting to what's going on in evolution. You can't say that the pains that you get when you're growing new muscles and doing exercises, you can't say that those are bad pains. Like if you have a headache or something like that, those are pains that are part of a natural growing process, and it goes on that way. So perhaps he is at a point in his seeking that his development is such that he's beginning to identify things even in the subconscious nature, which is indicated by the fourth house. He's trying to gain complete control of his whole being, and being able to be objective about his feelings is a step in that direction. Also, that close conjunction of Neptune to the ascendant would be consistent with that. It would be a deliberate, observational kind of sensitivity of what's going on and what's happening to him. But in all cases, he's clearly uncomfortable with his feelings. He would probably, in some ways, like to go back to an earlier evolutionary state where everything was on a par basis, instead of all of these flip-flop levels pulling him one way or another. But as things stand now, any effort to try and go back to that would be just another part of the flip-flops, and he'd be presented with a new dilemma. So he has to deal with what he has, we usually do. So the only way out of this is through the relieving aspects, most notably the relieving aspects to Mars. The sun sextiles Mars, and the moon is almost exactly trine to Mars. So by immediately acting on his feelings, whether he is conscious of them or not, he gets off of this dead center thing of feeling this and then sort of like quivering, you know, like being like some kind of animal or something that's a jellyfish, and you poke it with a pin and it just quivers because there's nothing it can do but sit there and quiver. And when he's on the dead center of the opposition, that's what happens to him. So if he acts immediately and carries things out, he's more likely to be emotionally healthy. And it's certain that he does that way, because the Mars is too strong to be ignored, and it is too perfect to not use as a tool. But the thing that is important about this is when he is utilizing the Mars as a relief planet, it is inward. Now, this is a horoscope of someone who is taking action, or who is working emotionally, inwardly, and behind the scenes. So in a way, he really is successful in his camouflage, in that he can work on his regenerative activity in the fourth and twelfth house opportunities without having to show it outwardly, and probably even feels a little chagrin that people do not know what's going on inside of him. So we can see here, in general, that this is an emotionality that is filled with fluent changes, and changes necessary in every part of it, and it is change that is done while in action, without stopping to plan or do anything deliberate like that. Overall, it's probably the most homogeneous emotionality of all of the charts that we've looked at so far, and probably will be for all of them, though Hermann Hesse maybe come close to it. All of the strongest planets in the emotionality are Venus, Mars, and the Moon. All of them are in air signs, which indicates a homogeneity, and it indicates a cultural influence that permeates his whole being. And so it is a pretty consistent emotionality, even though his life does seem rather unusual. You're laughing at?
Never mind.
I'm done.
What did you say is an ending of emotionality because of the 12th and 4th?
Yes. Yes.
But the moon is in its place in the 4th house.
Yes, so but the 4th house is...
But the 4th house is inward.
Is inward, yes. Inward. Yeah. So this is somebody that can literally work things out inside of himself. I imagine he might even have something like some kind of isomorphic emotional exercises or something like that. Any other questions?
Yeah. What would you say about Uranus' conjunctions as opposed to like Uranus trine Venus or, you know, conjunctions of... I mean, is there a tendency for the conjunction just to be that way?
Yes, yes. The immediacy is much greater with the conjunctions. We're going to run into one other Venus conjoined Uranus, and the immediacy there will be very obvious too. Like it's parallel to what happens between Mars and Venus. All the Mars and Venus aspects are falling in love. But they're not always quite as immediate as the love at first sight, where you have almost no say in the matter. It just happens, bam, and you're done. That's more likely to be a Mars conjoined Venus. I've seen it happen, where Mars conjoined Venus for two people who were in love with the same woman, but she was only in love with one, and it was much to the chagrin of the others. And they happened to have their Mars conjoined Venus in the same place that I had Mars, and I was with all three of them on a day when the moon went over that, and the the emotional interactions of that were quite interesting. That's it.
My sister-in-law went to a concert way back when.
Yes.
And he stopped the music all of a sudden right in the middle and wouldn't play until everybody shut up. Yeah. Is that Mars Uranus thing?
Yes, that's a little bit of it. But I think it isn't only just his feeling, his personal feelings about it. I think music is like a religion to him. He reverences the beauty of it, and he doesn't want somebody desecrating that any more than somebody would want their temple desecrated. Yeah. I'd like to see a concert. And maybe there are some old concerts of him.
Oh, wouldn't you love
to
see
that? Yeah.
The main song of his that I remember is
Moonshot.
Followed by a Moonshot.
Yeah.
What a beautiful song.
Yes, yes. I think he also did Morning Has Broken.
Okay.
Yeah.
And Peace Train.
What?
Peace Train.
Ah, yes.
We can go all night on that.